Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum and I'm here today at the Rock Island Auction Company where we are taking a look at what has got to be the most adorably cute little mortar you have ever seen in your life. This is a French Modele 1937 50mm light mortar. And like so much of the French ordnance in the 1930s, this really basically originated from World War I. So, The concept of this weapon was initially requested by the French military in 1924. They had come out of World War I, recognizing that basically every single French small arm in World War I was hopelessly obsolete as of 1918. The Lebel was obsolete before the war. The Berthier had been kind of squeezed into this rifle configuration and into service. The carbines were long obsolete. The machine gun, the Shosha, was not a particularly high quality design and really needed to be replaced. And the French, while they found that they really liked rifle grenades, they kind of also wanted a light mortar. Most of the other countries in the war had been using light mortars of various sorts, and they provided this really valuable intermediate sort of level of firepower, something that could be set up and deliver a large volume of fire but not be all that big, easily transported. Troops could bring light mortars with them on the advance or into, you know, forward observation sort of posts. You could do a lot with a light mortar. And so we would see this concept take off, in particular with the Japanese developing what Americans tend to call the knee mortar, the Type 89 and Type 10 grenade projectors, which are very similar in concept to this. The difference here is what the French came up with has that same basic mortar form factor, just made really small. This whole thing weighs about 3.6 kilos. That's like 8 pounds. I mean, this thing weighs less than a lot of rifles, and yet it's a 2-inch or 50mm mortar. Now, I say it was requested in 1924. Well, again, like so much of the French ordnance upgrade program, they thought they wanted it, and then it was delay, and then, oh God, war is about to happen. We really need guns right now. So it wasn't actually adopted until 1937, hence the 1937 designation, and late 37 at that. They finally agreed, okay, we have this design and it actually works now. We finally put off the development and the approval and the testing and all long enough. In January of 38, they placed an order for 21,950 of these, a whole crap load of light mortars. And then they bumped that order up shortly thereafter to 50,000 of them because, wow, you know, it looks like we're going to be needing these. The Germans are looking a little frightening over there. So by the time the Germans invaded in 1939, they had a grand total of 2,900, not nearly enough. And of course, production would end with the armistice in the spring of 1940. Now, production did pick back up in 1944. And these would go on to be used in Indochina in particular, and they'd have some application to French rifle grenades after the war, but we'll talk about that in a moment. Before we get to it, let's take a look at how this thing actually works. And before I do that, I actually want to point something out so that you can see it from the full perspective there. This thing folds up in this really slick way to that. That is your light mortar, and that would be super easy to drop into a pack or carry around with you. You can compare this to some of the other 50mm mortars out there, and this is slick. It's a folding mortar. I mean, come on, that's just really cool. So the way this thing is all held together is basically three little snap clips. So I can pop these two off. That opens up the leg assembly, flip that over, and then the leg assembly can spread out. And then we can open this sucker up like so. And presto, it's ready to use. So the basic setup of this thing is that it's always supposed to be at a 45 degree angle. And there's a little bubble level down here so you can determine that. And that is the purpose of this little spring-loaded wire and these hooks. When you are setting this up on something that isn't a perfectly flat tabletop, what you do is you're able to use this to adjust how far forward the legs can pivot so that you can get a 45 degree angle on the thing, even if you're on rough, you know, uneven terrain. You then have a very basic iron sight here on the front of the mortar. Pick it up so you can see that right there. You lift this up and you use this to aim, to set your windage. And if you're not aimed properly at the target, you can adjust that with this screw, which is going to traverse the thing side to side just a little bit. Nice little fine adjust there. There are marks on here. I don't know exactly what the demarcations are, but probably something in mils. So that's how you point the thing at your target properly. But then there's still a question of range. Of course, you don't want to overshoot or undershoot. So the way range is done on this thing is there's actually a series of vent holes in the tube itself right under this. And this can be screwed in and out, and that will progressively cover or uncover those vent holes. That impacts the amount of pressure that's generated when the shell fires, which in turn addresses, well, impacts how far it goes. So your minimum firing distance is 80 meters there, and then we can screw this through. Takes a little while to get up to 100, but then things start to increase, and our maximum effective range is, well, goes out to 460 meters. This is a little sticky right at the end. I'm not sure exactly what's going on there, but we can certainly get to 430. So basically, you're looking at 100 to 450 meters of range. That's not a huge amount, but remember that this is a little tiny mortar. The projectile that this thing throws is only about 0.4 kilos. It's basically a 1 pound mortar shell, which is kind of like a rocket-assisted hand grenade, really. However, the thing is so small and light and handy that you can take it anywhere, really. So you always have to balance in, you know, with something like this, power versus portability. And in this case, the French took the portability side. I would argue that this is maybe going to be a little bit slower to use than a rifle grenade, but it's definitely going to be more accurate, and it's going to be a lot simpler to set up a sustained barrage or a repeated fire on a position using this as opposed to a rifle grenade. I'm sure it's also more accurate. Once you've gotten everything lined up, you've got the range, you've got the windage, you've used the bubble level here to confirm that the mortar is at a 45 degree angle to begin with, so that your range setting is going to actually work, you then have this lever to fire it. That nice snap is the firing pin pulling back and then dropping. When you lift the trigger up, it resets. So this is not a fixed firing pin gun. When you're ready to start doing this, you drop the shell down in the tube, and then it fires when you pull the lever. This isn't one of those mortars like you often see where someone drops a shell down and then plugs their ears and the shell goes boom and fires as soon as it hits the bottom. There are not a lot of markings on here, but this is lance-grenade or grenade thrower, model 1937, a serial number on it there. And then we have a manufacturer's mark, MAP, on the bottom of the tube there. I should give proper credit. This was designed by a Captain Nahan, N-A-H-A-N, at the Chatellerault Arsenal in France. However, when it went into production, it was actually produced by, I think, four different companies. The Chatellerault Arsenal did produce them. This particular one was MAP, which is Manufacture des Armes de Paris, so a private company that also made rifle parts during World War I and clearly was well into the arms industry. So after the war, this would go on, it would go back into production, although I don't know a grand total of how many were actually ended up being made. It would be used in Indochina. I don't think it saw so much use in Algeria. What the French did initially is they took this 50 millimeter mortar shell, took the fin assembly off of it, basically, put on a new fin assembly and repurposed it or adapted it for use as a rifle grenade because they just couldn't get away from that rifle grenade idea. They really like those things. So the first semi-automatic rifles off the production lines after the war, the MOS 44 and the MOS 49, both have grenade launching setups for this style of grenade, basically the same projectile adapted to a rifle. And they would do the same thing with a version of the MOS 36. The L.Gr 48 has a grenade launcher set up for these. And all of those would see use in Indochina. Makes manufacturing easier when basically the business part of the mortar shell and the grenades are the same. So that would go on to change. Starting in 1951, In order to be more compatible with NATO, France went to a different style of rifle grenade, a 22 millimeter in diameter, that NATO standard. And that's when this was basically started to be phased out of service. And the rifle grenade launching went to the MOS 3651 and the MOS 4956, which were both set up for those new NATO-compatible grenades. So I find this thing just really cool. I actually have one of these myself that's deactivated. This particular one is not deactivated. This is a live, intact mortar registered under the National Firearms Act here in the US. So if you're interested in going through the NFA process, it's actually not quite as complicated as most people think. And hey, you can have yourself a live mortar. I'm not sure exactly how you would go about making ammunition for it. Of course, any explosive projectiles, actual mortar shells are also registered, would need to be registered as destructive devices in the US, but it certainly is legal and possible to set this thing up to fire inert projectiles with, I don't know, just shotgun shells, a propellant charge, or something. Anyway, I will leave that to whoever ends up buying this thing. If you would like to see Rock Island's description and pictures and value estimate, you can take a look at the description text below. A link there will take you to ForgottenWeapons.com, my website, and a link from there will take you over to Rock Island's catalog page. Thanks for watching.